What's up, guys? Charles here, and welcome back to another beautiful day in Jacksonville, Florida. If you watched my last video, you'll have seen that I asked a lot of you guys for questions for a Q&A. And first of all, I want to say thank you for all of your input. It was amazing. You guys really showed out for that. And there were a lot of things I hadn't considered before that I look forward to answering. But I also started to see trends. There were questions that a lot of people were asking, some that were recurring a lot, and some that I saw a lot of interest in on both Instagram and in the YouTube comments. And basically, rather than putting everything together into one giant video, I figured I would split it up into sort of a couple of different videos, some focusing on things that I think deserve more time to discuss because they're pretty in-depth topics, and others that are just gonna be fun, you know, answering random questions. And so the first of those today is one of the questions I've actually been getting for a while now. Even before the Q&A and after I said that out and I saw even more questions, I figured it's a video I should finally make. And it's kind of answering the question, why Stanford? And sort of explaining the journey that I went through to becoming a Stanford student athlete. I want to preface this video by saying everyone's experience with any school is going to be very different. So what happened with me may not happen with anyone else. I mean, even within our own grade and within our own sport, our differences varied widely. So this is more of like me telling my story rather than telling someone how to get into the school, because the admissions process isn't really an exact science. So just with that being said, I think we're all good to just get into the video. First of all, I think it's fitting to start with how my journey began. I think it was a little unconventional. The rules have changed since I was in high school, but as a sophomore, I reached out to, I want to say, 9 or 10 coaches from what I consider to be prestigious running schools. I think I'll show a couple of the emails there. And basically what I did was, I wasn't really sure whether they could speak to me, but I was really excited to start conversations with them. And I was coming off of a great sophomore year of cross country. So I figured it was a good point to start the conversation. Basically, I created a draft email where I would just explain, you know, who I was, where I came from, what my cross country achievements have been, and what my academic achievements have been, because that's what I thought they'd be most interested in. Because for most schools that have very strong athletics and academics, you're gonna have to get over the academic hurdle first. So I think showing strength in both is gonna be really important for most student athletes. And so basically I sent those out to a bunch of programs. I prefaced it by saying, I understand you're not able to reach out to me at this time, but I just wanted to sort of put myself on your radar and hopefully start a conversation. And for a lot of these, I got varying responses. All of them were very professional. Nobody really tried to jump the gun. And I think most of the responses I got were from assistant coaches who were just responding to inform me that they couldn't begin a conversation, but then they would direct me to their website where I could fill out a form that anyone could fill out. You just click on the recruiting part of the website and it sends in, basically like fill out your times, your GPA, stuff like that, and it sends it to the coaches. And I think it simplifies the process a lot for them. But because I hadn't really begun any real conversations, and because all I was doing was filling out forms I could have filled out anyway, at first it appeared as though those drafted emails weren't that helpful. Upon reflection, I think that, you know, it sends a really good message and it shows a lot of interest. That's what a lot of people, academic college counselors, people who are just talking about the process, like to emphasize, is showing interest in the school. I really believe in that because, you know, these schools only have so many students they can admit, and if they want to use those choices wisely, so they want to vouch for the students that will actually want to come to the schools, you know, if they get accepted. So I think that showing interest is something that's really important. Starting the conversation can be helpful. I know back then when I was, I want to say, a little bit cockier, I really thought it was cool when a college would reach out to me, and it kind of made me feel, you know, more valued by the institution. But now that I look back, it's, I don't think that's something anyone should really get caught up in. I think starting the conversation is really important because even if you want them to be the ones to reach out to show that they really do value you, there's a lot of kids that they have to look at. I think that's just the nature of the beast. When you think about how many students are doing your sport in the country, and then you also factor in international students and transfers, these coaches and assistant coaches really have their work cut out for them when they're deciding, you know, what's a kid that I really want who's gonna really contribute to my team. I think stuff like that's a moment where you just have to kind of swallow your pride and realize that in the sea of the masses, you could get overlooked, even though you're a very qualified candidate that would do really well at their institution. So I think as long as you are honest and you know, genuine with your intent, I don't think it can hurt. Sophomore year, that was kind of as far as the conversation developed. All of those schools were schools that I continued to be interested in, but I didn't really put much more thought into it. I still had 2 years left of high school, and I wasn't as worried about the process or where it would end up. So I kind of just sidelined it until I could start talking with the coaching staff, because that was gonna be, you know, my first impression of the school. And the coaching staff have an incredible influence on how their programs work out. And when you're spending so much time, you know, in those programs, I think that you can't really make a decision before you've talked to the coaches. So sophomore year ends, junior year begins, and I believe the summer of junior year is when the conversations really started. Almost all of those schools that I reached out to sophomore year ended up reaching back out to me as junior year began. And I thought that was awesome, because it was like that work had paid off. You know, just trusting in myself and the stuff that I've been lucky enough to achieve at that point. But obviously you're only halfway done with high school at the beginning of junior year, so there's a lot of, you know, maintaining and improvement to be done. So the conversations were very introductory at first, as, you know, they tend to be. Primarily your communication with the coaching staff is gonna be emails and calls. The emails were the first few steps, as you know, kind of got to know the coaching staff. And sometimes it's really hard to tell which ones were automated or copied and pasted, because obviously they're dealing with lots and lots of candidates. A lot of the discussion on that end is between you and the assistant coach, as you kind of figure out where your academic standings are, sort of the big races that you've got coming up and big performances that could help your case. Kind of the way it worked for me was I would talk to the assistant coach for a while and then the head coach for a little bit. And after I'd had enough conversations with the assistant coach, I'd get a call with the head coach, which was always kind of scary, but also, you know, exciting, because it was an opportunity to understand the program a little better. And so it was kind of that back and forth. A lot of the process was done with the help of assistant coaches, with the exception of certain schools where the head coach took a far more hands-on approach. And honestly, you know, you understand each school has different approaches to the process, and so you just have to be respectful of the way that they want to manage things and kind of just go with the flow. But the most important thing is, if you feel like you're not about it, it's okay to say, you know, you're not interested. I think one of the main things is you guys only have so much time to figure it out on both ends. They're trying to figure out whether they want you. You also should be equally, you know, critical about figuring out whether you want to be at that school. You don't want to burn bridges, I want to say, before you definitively know one way or the other, but I think it's important to be honest with yourself and upfront when something's just not working, or you know you're not going to go somewhere, because, you know, I think if you spread your time too thin between too many schools, it's harder to make an informed decision. You're introducing a lot more variables and a lot more things you've got to weigh against each other. So I tried to be as, you know, clinical and efficient as I could when I was whittling down the list. I can't remember exactly what schools there were, but I know there was Oregon, Boulder, Princeton. You know, I was considering any Ivy League, because those schools I'd always heard about when I was younger as being amazingly prestigious schools that I would have never have dreamed of being able to attend. Stanford is obviously on the list. And I was looking at UVA, too. And yeah, it was basically any school I knew I could run well at and also get a great education. And obviously some were stronger on the athletic end and some were stronger on the academic spectrum. But yeah, I knew I was excited about every option, which made it even harder to whittle some down. I mean, that's part of why I'm making this video. There's so many unknowns, you know, when you're heading into it blind that it's hard to make every decision perfectly, but I think I did, you know, the best job I could, trying not to waste, you know, anybody's time. And when I was having a conversation with someone who represented a school, it was a school that I really wanted to go to. And so that was the hardest part, was I think the beginning. I think once you're over the beginning, you're kind of in the clear, because you're done with this juggling act of, you know, dozens of schools, because it's not only the schools that you reach out to, but it's the schools that reach out to you as well that you've got to take into account. And so I've whittled the schools down now. I believe I had, oh sorry, I was looking at NAU as well. I don't know how I'll edit that in, but I'll try. So I whittled the schools down, I believe, to 3 by the end of junior year, beginning of senior year. There were two things that I really valued, obviously athletics and academics. And those three schools I felt best embodied their balancing of those two columns. I'll explain in a second. And so basically, first of all, I'd like to say the way that I rated this is not a knock on any of the schools. They're all extremely prestigious in both of those regards. And the schools are CU Boulder, Princeton, and Stanford. Prioritizing running while getting a good education But running is first and foremost. And Princeton was gonna be prioritizing education while having a very solid running career. You know, my academics would have been prioritized the most. And what I saw with Stanford was, you know, an opportunity where both of them were at the highest standard. And I knew I would have a really hard time getting in. So I was trying not to overfixate on any school, but I felt that if I wanted to have the most agency and the most choice in my life, Stanford was the best option, because by being able to have both pillars of what I valued the most, you know, if anything were to happen, obviously knock on wood, I pray it doesn't, but if anything crazy were to happen, I would be secure in, you know, either of those options. The next step in the process was official visits. And those were crazy. So I never planned an official with any of the schools I mentioned before, except for CU Boulder, Princeton, and Stanford. I fully intended to go on all of them, but I ended up only going on two because of how timing worked out. The Princeton one ended up being really easy. I ended up just driving to Princeton with the coach. He picked myself up and a couple of other runners from the Manhattan Invitational right after I ran it senior year, and we just drove over to campus. That was a great visit. I really fell in love with the school, and I thought, even though the official was great, it made it very hard when, obviously you guys know what my final decision was. What that visit did is it really clued me into the importance of getting onto campus, whether or not the coach is willing to fly you out there or you get yourself out there for an unofficial visit. Because even though it was just for, you know, a day and a bit, I really got to experience what it was like to be on that campus and to be a part of that team. And the guys were awesome. They were so nice and accommodating to me. And the hardest part is I knew I would have been really happy there, and, you know, to be at a school like Princeton is obviously an incredible achievement, and their running team is really solid, and it's a beautiful campus. Leaving that official, I'd had an amazing time, and I knew it was going to make the decision difficult. I was told that, you know, I had a good chance of getting in if I were to apply, but the way that the Ivies like to recruit, it's a bit of a aggressive strategy, but it's smart, is they need you to go in on an early decision, which essentially means that you apply to the school early decisions earlier than anyone else applies. And if you get in, you have to go there. It's binding. But if you don't apply early decision, you have a much more difficult time actually getting into the school. It's a bit of a difficult choice, because you have to make the decision early. And at this point, I hadn't heard back from Stanford as to whether or not I get in. It was a little bit scary, because I knew if I missed the early decision window, I might have compromised my chances of going to Princeton, which was the school I had a great official at. But at the same time, thanks to the pillar system I created, I knew that Stanford was kind of the choice. If I got in, I thought that Stanford would be the best choice for myself as a student athlete. And with CU, I hadn't had my official yet, even though I know I love Boulder. I think Colorado is one of my favorite places on the planet. So I knew I'd be happy there, you know, running and training and getting a good education. And so it was really coming down to the wire. I only had a couple of months. I was just waiting to hear back from Stanford. But if I didn't hear back, or if I didn't get in, I would have to make that call to go to Princeton or not. I had my Boulder official going up, because for all I knew, that was gonna shake things up as well. I read so much about the school and running with the Buffaloes, and that really made me fall in love with the idea of the program. And I know that their coach, Coach Webmore, is an absolute legend. And on my official at Stanford, I loved it just as much. It really cemented itself as my first choice. The location, the team, and just the environment of being on campus was amazing. Even though I whittled it down to three schools, it still remained to be a really difficult decision. My heart was still locked into Stanford, but I hadn't gone on my Boulder official yet, and I wasn't sure how that would change things. The day before I left for my Boulder official, I remember, I think it was a Sunday, I got a call from the assistant coach at Stanford saying, you know, you got in, congratulations, call us back whenever you want to tell us your decision, no pressure. And it was crazy. I mean, part of me really wanted to go on that Boulder official, but another part of me had made my mind up. For one, I thought the most important thing was I didn't want to waste their time. Obviously, I felt bad that I had to cancel an official the day before, but I think I would have felt even worse knowing that I wanted to go to Stanford and having them spend a whole weekend, you know, touring me around. And when I knew at that point my decision was made, I ended up having to cancel the official because I committed the same day to Stanford. And the process was not over. But the recruiting process was over at that point. I decided on Stanford for the strength of the academics and the strength of the athletics. So I didn't really have to sacrifice anything. And I thought it was just a great opportunity to live in a state that really interested me, which was California, and has continued to interest me even as I've been there. Another reason I went is the recruiting class and the grades above me are full of so much unbelievable amounts of talent that, you know, it's a tremendous opportunity to train with guys at a level that I never would have imagined myself training alongside. You know, I still get overjoyed every time I go to practice or there's a workout and, you know, we're just slamming the reps because, you know, that was such a huge reason why I wanted to go there. And I'm so glad that it's held true. Just to talk about the process of recruitment, the way I worked with Stanford was, they sent me an application over the summer. I basically got all my essays and stuff. I was able to look over them and, you know, prepare for them over summer, but I wasn't able to submit them until, you know, the school year really began. I was told that I would hear back in about 2 weeks or so, but it wasn't guaranteed. And they ended up waiting something like 3 months. And after 3 months of waiting, we finally heard back that I got in, and, you know, everyone's crying in my house. It was unreal. It was one of the best days of my life, for sure. But after that, they just said you have to maintain, you know, X grades, and that was pretty much it. I maintained those grades through the rest of my senior year, and after that, you know, I was shipped off to California. You know, when we talk about why Stanford, I've talked a lot about it in this video, but just to summarize, it was, I think, the perfect school for me. I really like the old coaching staff when they're recruiting me, but I really love the new coaching staff now. The guys I'm training with are absolutely amazing, and they have exceeded my expectations, which were astronomically high already. The academic aspect of it has been so perfect. Obviously, with the situation we have right now, not being, you know, in-person classes, it's not ideal, but those 2 quarters I had at the beginning and just the community I've been able to immerse myself in has made it absolutely worth it, and I can't wait to see where these next couple years go. And so I hope this video answered your guys' questions. I know a lot of you guys asked about my GPA. If you guys really want to talk about numbers, feel free to message me on Instagram, so it can be a little bit more of a private discussion rather than me just, you know, throwing it out to the world, because you know, that's not really something I want to do. I know there's a lot of questions that weren't answered in this video, but there will be more, I promise. And yeah, I love talking to you guys, and I love the interest that you guys have shown in these aspects of my life. It really means a lot to me. As I've said in other videos, I hope you guys found this informative. Till next time, I hope you guys enjoy yourselves. I hope you stay safe, and I'll see you all next week.